One of the things we get to do is an introductory exploration of species counterpoint. Now, in general, counterpoint tends to refer to the interaction among multiple voices in any given piece of music, right? So the way the voices kind of work independently, but also in a coordinated way. And this study of counterpoint is going to do a couple of things for us. First of all, it's going to give us some, you know, more concrete musical examples to see how intervals interact with each other. And it'll also give us a way to start to think about multi-voice writing, which will be a big feature of our theory study going forward. When we talk about species counterpoint, we're referring to a way of contrapuntal writing that is framed by what are some pretty well-defined guidelines. Those guidelines apply to each of five different species. We'll just concern ourselves with the first and second species here. Each species is defined by one of the various ways in which a particular voice will interact with another voice, with that other voice having kind of a predetermined set of notes, which we would call the cantus firmus. In first species counterpoint, there is a one-to-one ratio. For every note of cantus firmus, there is one note of counterpoint. Those move at the same rate. In second species, there is a two-to-one ratio. So for every note of cantus firmus, we have two notes of counterpoint. There are guidelines for what it takes to write a good cantus firmus, but for our purposes, we'll use cantus firmuses or cantus firmi, canti firmus. Anyways, we'll use ones that are already in existence, and we'll focus our attention on how to write good counterpoint to the cantus firmus. Successful counterpoint skillfully intermixes both the independence of each voice and the interdependence or connectedness between the voices. So independently, each voice proceeds in a way that's coherent and musically pleasing, but it also cooperates interdependently with the other voices in a way that they kind of interlock or they kind of just make sense together. Fundamental to understanding counterpoint is being able to distinguish between consonant intervals and dissonant intervals. Consonant intervals are those intervals that, at least by conventional standards, sound good together. The music sounds pleasant or settled, whereas dissonant intervals implies a bit of tension or things that kind of sounds that kind of rub together. The consonant intervals are the unisons, the thirds, the fifths, the sixths, and the octaves. Now, within this group, we can subdivide between the perfect consonances, the unisons, the fifths, and the octaves, and the imperfect consonances, the thirds, and the sixths. The dissonant intervals, then, are the seconds, the fourths, and the sevenths. Now, the fourth, you may remember, tends to be a perfect fourth in many situations, but for the purposes of counterpoint, we consider it a dissonance, even though it often appears as a perfect interval. We have to be very careful in our treatment of consonant intervals, both melodically across each voice independently, as well as harmonically, so whether or not we have consonances or dissonances between voices. Some of the guidelines we have around treatment of the harmonic relationships between the upper and lower voice or between the counter melody and the cantus firmus include that we are only in first species going to use consonant intervals. In fact, we're primarily going to use imperfect consonant intervals, thirds and sixths. There are times when we can and in fact should use perfect consonances, especially the perfect fifth and the perfect octave. The very last note must feature a perfect octave between the cantus firmus and the counterpoint. The first note can be either a perfect fifth or a perfect octave. We may have perfect fifths or perfect octaves show up somewhere in the middle of the counterpoint, but we have to be careful that of two things. First of all, they should be approached by contrary motion, which is to say, if one voice arrives at the interval by moving upward, the other voice should arrive at that interval by moving downward. Also, we can never have two or more consecutive fifths or two or more consecutive octaves. As we use our thirds and sixths, we want to be sure that we never use more than three thirds in a row or three sixths in a row. You can certainly freely alternate between thirds and sixths. As I mentioned before, we have some guidelines about the harmonic intervals that should appear at the beginning and the end of our counterpoint. The beginning of our counterpoint should feature either a perfect fifth between the voices or a perfect octave, and the end of the counterpoint should feature a perfect octave. Now, here's what that means in terms of the key. The cantus firmus will always begin and end on the first scale degree or on the do. That means at the beginning, then, the counter melody or the counterpoint will either sound at the do or the first scale degree or the sol, the fifth scale degree. At the very end, since that last harmonic interval must be an octave, both voices will be on the first scale degree. We also have some guidelines for the second to last note in each part. The second to last note in each part should form a sixth, and here's how it's going to do that. The cantus firmus will always have the second scale degree, or the re, and the counter melody should always have the leading tone just before the end, or the T. When you have that, you then create a sixth, or specifically a major sixth, as the penultimate or the second to last interval. As we're thinking melodically in terms of creating our counter melody, or what we can call the counterpoint itself, we want to be thoughtful about a few things. For one thing, we want to make sure that we're favoring stepwise motion and that we're being very careful with our leaps. Stepwise motion occurs anytime you move from a given note either up or down by just one more note. A leap happens when you move by more than one note, in other words, moving an interval of a third or more. When we do leap, a few things we want to keep in mind. We never want to leap a seventh of any kind. If we leap a fifth, which should be rare, which I'll get to in a second, but if we leap a fifth, we want to make sure that it's a perfect fifth and not a diminished fifth, which would be a tritone, which is actually a dissonant interval, even though it's a generic interval of a fifth. It's okay to leap the dissonance of a perfect fourth. That's generally okay. But most of our leaps really should be thirds if we're going to use them at all. So primarily leaping by thirds, occasionally leaping by a perfect fourth, rarely leaping by a perfect fifth, nothing bigger than a perfect fifth. If you are going to leap a perfect fifth, and sometimes even with a perfect third, it's a really good idea to follow that leap with stepwise motion in the opposite direction. I kind of think of that as filling in the hole left by the leap. So let's dive into some specifics as we look at first species counterpoint. In the two-part species counterpoint that we'll be doing, the cantus firmus will always be provided for us and will always serve as the lower of the two voices. Our job will be to write a counter melody or the counterpoint to that cantus firmus, always in the upper voice. So here I've created an example of first species counterpoint following the guidelines that we've been talking about. Now, these guidelines and much of our discussion of counterpoint is heavily informed by the textbook Counterpoint in Composition by Felix Salzer and Carl Schachter. In fact, the counterpoint that you're looking at here includes a cantus firmus, right, that appears in that textbook along with a bunch of other cantus firmuses, cantus firmi, all of which prove really, really helpful for learning counterpoint. So let me just kind of show you how I've got things set up here, right? I've written on the grand staff and I've indicated that it's a grand staff by joining the staves with this line here and including the bracket there. Okay, I've set up my two staves, my treble clef up top, my bass clef on the bottom, and as I stated, we're always going to have a cantus firmus as the lower note, and then we'll write our counterpoint or the counter melody in the line above that. Okay, I've drawn bar lines through the entire system, so I can be really, really clear about, you know, what's where. Now, you may notice that I don't have a time signature. I have not marked 4-4 here, and that's really just indicative of the fact that this is more of kind of an exercise than it is a true composition. I don't have to use whole notes when I'm writing counterpoint. I just, you know, it's a nice way to do it because I can kind of just see where all the notes are and just kind of see how the notes move from one to the other. But again, it's not a strict composition. These are not necessarily to be played for four beats. It's just kind of a series of notes here. Okay, and then I make sure that I end my exercise with a double bar. Okay, so as I mentioned before, this cantus firmus appears in the Salzer and Schachter textbook, but it appears in the key of C major. And what I've done is I've transposed it. So I've moved it from the key of C major, and I've kind of moved everything to, in this case, the key of A major. So everything's gone down a minor third. So I moved the first note from being the tonic C to a tonic A. And same thing with the last note, and then everything else moves down a minor third to go along with that. So I say I've written in the key of A major, and I have, but you don't see a key signature for A major. What I've done is I've purposely omitted the key signature, and instead I'm marking all of the notes that are not natural, that correspond to the key of A major. I've marked the sharps for all of those. And in our early study, especially of music theory, that's a really good habit to get into, because it forces us to be really always consciously aware of exactly which pitches we're working with, which is going to have implications for things like our intervals and then later on our chords and those kinds of things. So that's one of the things that I do just as kind of a matter of again, being very detail oriented here. So no key signature, but it's still the way the notes are written reveals the fact that I'm in A major. Okay, so let's kind of take a look at what I have in, well, I'll show you the notes I have in black. This just kind of reflects the fact that these are just a given, right? These are kind of fixed for me. In fact, cantus firmus is Latin for fixed voice. I don't have any control over those notes. That's kind of where they are, all right? But then you see I've written in some things in purple here. I've written things in purple that, even though they're not kind of like spelled out for me in terms of the notes themselves, they're spelled out for me in terms of the guidelines that I want to see, especially at the beginning and ends of my exercise. I know that the last harmonic interval in the exercise, in other words, the last interval between the lower note and the upper note, should be an octave, right? So before I do anything else, I just write in my last note. I just know it has to be an octave. My first note could be a fifth or an octave, so I've chosen an octave here. I often start with an octave. I just find that it's often more, it gives me a little bit more flexibility. That's not always the case. Sometimes starting with the fifth works just fine, but in this case, I've chosen to start with the octave. I also know that the penultimate harmonic interval should be a sixth, and it should be a sixth created from the fact that, as I mentioned before, in the cantus firmus, we have the second scale degree, or the re, right, which leads down to the tonic pitch. And in the counter melody, right, in the upper voice here, we should have a leading tone, or the T, which should then resolve up to the tonic pitch. So these notes, which are kind of spelled out in terms of what they should be, will create the interval of a sixth. So again, that's just something else I wrote in along with the other purple things here, even before I got to kind of the stuff in the middle. All right, so I want you to notice I've marked my intervals, right? My harmonic intervals between each kind of pair of notes here as I go along the way. But notice how I've only written in the numeric portion of the interval, what we kind of refer to as the generic interval. I have not written in the interval quality. And that reflects just kind of a convention of counterpoint writing where we write in the numeric piece, but we do not write in the major, the minor, those other kinds of things, the perfects, okay? And that isn't because they don't matter. I do have to be cognitive of those. It's just kind of, a convention that we use. So, but that does mean I've got to be very, very careful, especially with intervals that could form a dissonance without my necessarily seeing it on the page. For example, this fifth I have here, right? As long as that fifth is a perfect fifth, it's going to be permissible between the counterpoint and the cantus firmus, right? But if, for example, it was somehow a diminished fifth, well, that wouldn't work because that's actually a tritone, which is a dissonant interval. So even though I don't write in the qualities, I still need to be very cognizant of what those qualities are so I can kind of make sure that, you know, I'm sticking to the rules, so to speak. Okay, so let's kind of look at the intervals that I have used. I mentioned where I have kind of my fixed intervals that have to be there, but as I look through the blue here, you'll see, as I mentioned before, we really should favor imperfect intervals. So most of the intervals you see here are thirds and sixths, right? As I mentioned, it's possible to have kind of a perfect interval pop up somewhere in the middle, but that's not really where we want to place our emphasis. As we use our imperfect intervals, remember that we never want to have more than 3/6 in a row or 3/3 in a row. So I've tried to follow that here. I've got 2/6, right? And then I break the pattern by throwing in a third. And then I go to a sixth here, and then I have a couple of thirds here, right? And then I get to a fifth here. And then I do have 3/6 in a row here, which is fine, but that's kind of my limit. So I just kind of break it here, right, with the octave. And of course, that makes sense because this is the penultimate interval. It should be a sixth, which should then lead to an octave, okay? So now let's take a look at this fifth. Right? Remember, I said that we can have perfect intervals pop up in the middle, but we want to make sure that we approach the perfect fifth or in a perfect octave, as the case may be, in what's called contrary motion. And contrary motion means that as one note moves up into that interval, the other voice moves down into that interval. And that's what I have here. I have the cantus firmus, okay, which leaps up to join the fifth here, whereas my counterpoint line or my counter melody line walks down, right? So they approach that fifth in opposite directions. Now, theoretically, it could have been the other way around. It could have been that the upper note moves up into the perfect interval while the lower note moves down in the perfect interval. It just so happens that that's what I have here. In fact, I do have that reverse kind of happening here as I approach my final octave, right? The upper note moves up, the lower note moves down. In any event, they approach that perfect interval by contrary motion. Okay. Speaking of contrary motion, if we just kind of step back and look, I want you to notice how there's a fair amount of contrary motion between the two lines all the way through. Not in every instance, okay? But I do have, for example, at the beginning where I kind of walk down while the lower part moves up in the cantus firmus, okay? And then they move in parallel here. That's fine. A little parallel motion is fine. Then they go contrary again, up here, down here, up, while this one goes down, okay? And then they move in towards each other. Then they move in parallel, that's fine, okay? Then again, approaching that fifth in contrary motion, all right? And then a little bit of parallel, well, not parallel, but similar motion. We'll talk about the difference between those later down the road, okay? And then parallel motion here, okay, parallel motion here, and then finally, it ends in contrary motion. And one of the hallmarks of well-done counterpoint is that you have a fair amount of contrary motion between the voices. Okay. Another thing that's really important to think about, which I didn't mention earlier in the video, but I'll talk about here, is if you study kind of any good cantus firmus, it's going to have a really nice melodic contour, right? It's not going to really meander in one place for too long, and this kind of has some peaks and valleys as we saw there. We want to have that same kind of shapeliness reflected, or maybe not exactly the same, but we want to have some level of shapeliness reflected in the counter melody as well. Okay, so as you can see, this kind of comes here, but then it starts to trend upward and kind of peaks at this D before gradually kind of winding its way down, right? So it's got kind of a story. It makes kind of a journey. What we don't want to do is create melodies or counter melodies that kind of meander and just kind of, stay along one note. I had a teacher who just really kind of made fun of them as just kind of like these slow trills, right? We don't want slow trills. We want to see some kind of some variety, especially having kind of a focal point or a peak at some point along the way, all right? Hey, I'm interrupting myself here just to point out one other detail here. Notice that the motion in my counter melody is primarily stepwise, right? As we mentioned earlier, we primarily want to use stepwise motion. In other words, just moving to neighboring notes up or down. You do see that I have a few leaps, but there's only a couple of them, right? And each of those leaps is a third. If I can avoid leaps, especially leaps larger than a third, I like to do that. That's not always possible, but in this case, I was able to get away with it. So again, just focusing our attention for just a second here on the fact that I have primarily stepwise motion, only a few leaps, and I'm keeping them as small as I can. So these are some of the things that I've thought about as I've created this counterpoint. Let's go ahead and take a listen to what it sounds like. So hopefully what you heard reflected is what we talked about kind of near the opening, where when we talk about counterpoint, we're talking about independent musical lines that work well on their own, that have musical interest on their own, but also fit together really, really well. So it's kind of this multifaceted musical experience. So hopefully you've heard that here, and it gives you a sense of how first species counterpoint can work.